perfect fit for some of you now, when you're some of you that do takeout. It's not a fit for all of you, but some of you maybe. So and I'm trying to find stuff like that, and I need a place to dump these things when I find them. So I think it might be this Facebook page, and then maybe Valerie could be the one that kind of alerts everybody that there is all of this jumping into this Facebook page, and you know, get some social media stuff going so that there's a place to put all these, because these are not, you know, ideas for how to do takeout. That's not something City Hall needs to have anything to do with. It's not relevant to them. But then I also look constantly, I have all these things coming into my inbox of just what's happening, what are the other cities doing? And right now the newest I'm seeing is that Boston has approved outdoor dining through December 1st. I'm not sure there are concepts of how to make that work, but it's approved. And New York City just approved an up to 10% surcharge on inside dining. The restaurants would call it the COVID-19 recovery charge. It's very controversial. However, their city council approved it 46-2, which also means there's 48 people on the New York City City Council, which is,
wow.
I can't even go there.
Can you imagine?
I can't imagine. I also can't imagine that they put in this thing for a surcharge on restaurant bills, and it was almost unanimously approved. So that was a new one to me too. And I don't even know here if that's something the city needs to do, or a restaurant on its own can
tell. Yeah, that would probably be a state. That would have to go through the state to do something like that.
I mean, my dentist does it. Dentists have a surcharge right now, just randomly.
It's tough enough getting people in it's tough enough getting people in a restaurant. I just think that's ridiculous to do a COVID-19 surcharge.
Funny because the restaurants didn't like it.
Yeah.
The article I read said the restaurants said, I don't think so. But the city approved it. So,
yeah. I mean, unless the funds went directly back to a support pool for the restaurants themselves.
The restaurant kept it. It didn't go to the city.
Oh, the restaurant's supposed to keep it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It was for the restaurant.
So oh, I see. Okay, I missed that part.
So most of the restaurants that were doing it said maybe 1%, would maybe throw 1% on them. But the city approved up to 10%. So I don't know, just throwing that out. I mean, it's interesting to see what other cities do. But I mean, what we'd love to hear with some restaurants on here is, what are you doing? What can we do to help you? And what are your strategies? Like, we don't hear your voices on these calls, and I would love to hear from you.
If I can jump in, Ann, I just got the invitation on Friday for this meeting. I've not sat in on any of them, so my intention was just to kind of hear you all out and see what was going on. So I'm not fully prepared, but things like the outdoor seating, some areas can handle this and some can't. But you talked about the igloos, and it's something that I've been looking into a little bit, and I don't know if that can happen in Portsmouth or not, but even a small amount of tables in an enclosed area that's heated, you see them throughout Canada, you see them throughout colder temperature, you're seeing them in Boston right now, they're popping up all over the place. Mm-hmm. New York City. I know that the city has some concerns about plowing, but I think there's ways that we can work around that. That's not going to hit all the masses, but that's certainly one of the things that I've been looking into. I will prolong the outdoor seating as long as I can. That's absolutely my goal right now, because it's been a godsend.
Which means the big obstacle right now is city council approval, because right now you're still only permitted to the 18th.
Yep.
Right. And tomorrow night, I believe it comes back on the docket tomorrow night.
James, did that come up last Monday at all?
Email your councilman.
Absolutely. I think it's important this is Martha speaking. I got on a little late. Very important to have a number of restaurants who are interested in staying open longer, and maybe Valerie from the chamber as well, to reach out to all the members of the city council and point out that this is happening elsewhere.
I mean, it's interesting that Boston is December 1st. I'm curious. I don't know anything other than that. Just that date was just approved last week.
James, you had a thought?
Yeah, well, just to say that at the last city council meeting, I relayed the recommendation of task force to extend from October 18th to October 31st. It was not voted on, but that's the status right now. So I'm hoping that is on their agenda. And then there's a linkage to the state, and that the state needs to extend the liquor situation beyond October 1st. So that's everything.
And Nancy Carmer sounded like she had sort of an informal, don't worry about that too much, because the governor can only extend 3 weeks at a time.
Right.
So we won't hear about that. But was that from the governor or the governor's office to Nancy saying, we'll work with you, don't worry about that?
But so good. I'm here and I can respond to that. It's just that the governor can only extend for 3 weeks at a time. So on October 1st, I asked the commissioner of the Business and Economic Affairs office to take that up. And he said that he would take that up. He is also now the new chairman of the Gopher Committee. So that's where that stands. I'm pretty sure that will happen, but it can't hurt to keep pressure on.
Nancy, so is there someone we should be in touch with on that?
Do you think that a letter from the task force supporting that would be helpful?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Then we need to put that together. Have someone put it together.
I can help. I can maybe draft something and run it by all of you.
That'd be great.
And we could approve it at our Wednesday full task force meeting. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Perfect.
Sounds good.
I feel like it was one of the city council's sticking points. Someone kept going back to, but why extend it if there's no liquor? So it was a which comes first problem.
So when you say it can only be extended 3 weeks at a time, is that what the Liquor Commission says?
I don't think any of us know. That's just the answer Nancy got when she asked how long.
If we could get the governor to issue an executive order to allow for that extension of the liquor license to continue to December 1st, then you don't have to keep going back.
Yep.
Yeah, the understanding is that, right, Nancy, that he's just going to keep extending it every 3 weeks.
That's the indication that I got, but let me reach out to my contacts at BEA, find out what exactly is the source for the 3 weeks and then get back to you folks. And in the meantime, I'll draft something to the Gopher Committee.
But you could, you know, even put in the letter that, you know, extending it for 3 weeks, but ideally we would like to find a way to get permission up to December 1st. So the business community, the restaurant community can plan.
Correct.
Yeah, right now we're only planning on going through November 1st in discussions with city staff in terms of snow removal, et cetera. But we certainly can discuss that more as we go down the road for the next couple of weeks and see how people do as it gets colder, et cetera. So, John, Golan, you want to?
I think that the fact that Boston decided to go to December 1st, we should at least point that out. No?
Yep.
I'm here, Mark.
They've actually closed streets.
Right.
Martha, in many cases, which we have been told we cannot do except
right.
shortly, yeah, except for short term. So, and it has to do a lot with safety and access and so forth. So, which makes a lot of sense. John Gollum, do you have anything to add to you want to discuss about how the city can help the restaurants in terms of going forward into the winter?
Mark, what I'd like to do if I can is play cleanup, because I see there's Brendan Massimo, and I know, hi Massimo, how are you?
Hi.
There's a, and I forgot the other young lady's name. I'm trying to click through here.
Nimi. Nimi.
Nimi.
Peter LaBrie.
I just thought maybe I could defer to them. Peter LaBrie, I know he's not on volume yet, but it would be interesting to hear from other people, and then I could kind of, kind of pitch in at the end. That's my thoughts right now, Mark.
Good. So just give everybody an overview. You know, we were established in May, and as Ann said, started working right away and got through the city's help, barriers out there very, very quickly. But now we're sitting here saying, what are we going to do in the winter? Because we know you all are with the COVID outline, probably 35-40% is the seats you can use inside, and a lot of you don't have decks, and we are going to probably have to pick up those barriers for snow plowing and et cetera. So what we're hoping to get is a discussion on how we can help the restaurants survive the winter. And, you know, like Ann just talked about putting some kind of subscription together, and the other thing that's been discussed is how we can help you with making takeout easier, et cetera. So Pete or Brendan or Nimi, do you want to chime in?
I can chime in quickly. So we're on private property. So for us, you know, we can do, our patio is private, so we can do whatever we want with our patio. I can stay open until January 15th if I want to. However, weather is going to make that a non-starter. Already it's becoming a problem with a lot of guests who, you know, insist on being outside until they get there and realize that it's not 75 degrees. But I guess the thing that I'm having the biggest trouble with, despite confirmation calls and advance bookings and all this stuff, is last minute cancellations. And I don't want to deter people from not coming if they don't feel well. I'd rather lose the money. But I've heard overheard conversations at the bar with people who are coming for a drink and then, you know, and a snack and then going somewhere else at dinner, saying, I've got 4 reservations tonight. Do you want to go to, you know, do you want to go to Black Trumpet or the Atlantic Grill or Raleigh? And they're just, you know, and like, I hear that and I'm just like, you're out of your mind. Like, how can you be so inconsiderate? But when I share with other people, they're like, they think they're helping. So some kind of like, I don't know how the city does this or how the chamber does this, but some type of educational campaign about what kind of the new dining contract between us and the customer is, because we're all trying, but we can only push so hard against our actual customers. So something that helps them understand, I mean, 80% of our customers are amazing, but the other 20%, if you cancel on me for a 6-person party at 6:30 on Saturday night, that's half my dining room. Like, I can't fill that quickly or safely, because we no longer are allowing people to wait outside for a table because we're not going to have one and the waiting situation's not safe. So, I mean, we've toyed with the idea of deposits, but that just feels like we're now financially incentivizing people to come in when they are sick, or to, I don't know. And I might get that far and take it anyways for the winter because we just can't do it. But some educational campaign doesn't make us look like we are demanding this from the diner. If that makes sense to anybody else, that's kind of where I'm at.
Brendan, if I may jump in on that, For a number of years, I've required a credit card to hold reservations. We're not taking a deposit. We have a, you can set it up however you want. We happen to have a $20 per person day of cancellation policy. I ask people to call us by noontime the day of. If they don't cancel their reservation, we reserve the right to charge $20 per person. I've been doing that for about 15 years, and I don't think I've ever actually charged anybody. It's just more the incentive for them. There's one more item that's making them, you know, want to call you to cancel it if they're not going to make it. And if somebody called me at 3 o'clock in the afternoon or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I still am fine with it because it gives me enough time to try and rebook that table. It's those no shows or really last minute cancellations that now you're out of table. You're out for your staff, you know, the tip, and you're out for yourself, the house. So I've been doing it for a number of years. Years ago, people would question it. Today, people give me their credit card without even a second thought for the most part there. So I don't know if that helps, but I've been doing it for a long time. I'm not out to try and charge anybody $20 for not showing up or not calling, but it really does help people, keeping them honest and calling you if they're not gonna be able to make it.
Yeah, I get that. I just feel like at the same time with the restaurant deposit thing's been happening in cities for a long time, right? Like it's common on a lot of services now, but we're also asking for masks and distancing and telling them they can't come when they want to come. And I just feel like the restaurants are having to ask a lot of their customers right now, which is fine. That's the business we're all in, is what we agreed to do. But we're all basically asking the same thing. And so if there was, you know, if there's a way for that small percentage of people who just don't get it, that like, this is required of where you go. And now with the new, with the increased mask usage, we're supposed to also be asking them if they're in the same household and if they're not to wear a mask at the table. And like, it's just one more step of like something else that an already like skeleton staff in order to increase social distancing is trying to pull off in a day, with also planning for increased absenteeism due to symptoms as soon as people start getting colds. So
I get it. I get it. If there could be more education, or John from Cava always says, can we guilt people into it? If there is something like that that we can do, I'm all about it.
I always feel like you can start these grassroots campaigns pretty easily on social media. And when they come from people who aren't you, it almost reads better. Like, I launched something out there and I'm not a restaurant owner, so it's not self-serving to me. It's just me kind of throwing something out there, and sometimes get a lot of traction. So, you know, I did not know this as a problem. I'm awful. Something I'll start to jump on social media.
It's a real problem.
Valerie.
So I think that WMUR might be able to do a piece on this. So, because I think it's critically important and they'll reach more people. So let me reach out to Jen and see if we can't get WMUR to come in and talk with some of you folks. Brendan, okay. Massimo, would you be interested? And we've got Peter and Nimi and John. So I'll reach out to all of you and see if we can't schedule something, because I think it's a really important message to get out there.
It's a real problem.
All right, that's really important. And I'm also, as you're talking, I'm also making some notes that I'll send out. I'm sending out an email to all the downtown all restaurants later this afternoon, and I'll just include some of these notes with them. So if I have any questions, I'll reach back out to you, okay?
Thank you.
Oh, and I noticed here in my notes, just on these, how late are you going to go? It's New York City is still at October 31st. So that has not budged.
Martha.
I wondered about working with the city to designate in various places one parking space that people could have for pickup in over the winter. So that we're making it easier for people to do the pickup.
For takeout.
For takeout. I'm sorry.
And didn't the city do something along those lines back in the in the spring?
Yes, they did.
So I think we should reinstitute that and make sure that those spaces are in the appropriate places.
I think they're still there.
Yep, that's my understanding. But it's also worth making sure we may need more. given that we took up a lot of space with the dining, right?
Right, when we lose the dining. And Valerie, wasn't it you or someone talked about numbering the spaces? When you pull in, you call the restaurant and say, I'm in space number 11, and they run it out to your car?
Yes. So I'd love to hear from the restaurants on the call here. What's the best way to do this? We've talked about a couple of different things, just having some 15-minute pickup spaces or actually numbered spaces that would be shared by not only the restaurants, but also the retailers. The retailers are going to have pickup as well. You know,
That's true.
Curbside pickup. So how many, what we need to hear from the restaurants is how many do you need? Where do they need to be? You know, do you need like five in front of your, that are shared? We just need your input on that.
I think that's important. It would be very helpful to have their input.
Yeah, I guess the question is did you find during the ugly March and April timeframe and May timeframe that was an important part of your business, or that you could, you possibly could make it an important part of your business, the takeout?
If I can jump in, it was, yep. It was a huge help late spring, I should say. We didn't have the takeout for a few weeks into the pandemic, maybe the first month and a half we weren't doing it. But then after that, we had three parking spaces out front that we shared with Ceres Bakery next door. They were doing the same thing in the morning and lunch, and I used those spaces in the evening. And it was a big help to have them. People would pull up. For me, two spaces was plenty. And it was really convenient and a huge help. The thing with the takeout, it's a small percent. It's a help. It's a small percent of your overall business, though. It's a subsidy. A restaurant certainly isn't going to make big numbers on takeout. And I think we did it successfully and did it really well. I heard other people it wasn't quite as successful. For me it worked, but it's a small fraction of what we really need. But having the parking spaces up front was a big help for sure.
Pete, LaBrie, or Mimi, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, this is Pete LaBrie. Sorry, my camera's not working, but we have one spot in front of the River House currently. We use it all the time. Not to sound, whatever, but we could use five spots. I mean, to Massimo's point, takeout's a small percentage, but when you have people pulling in looking for parking spots and that spot's taken up, they drive around, they don't show up. They either cancel or don't show up. So yes, those parking spots are extremely helpful. I'm sure the retail would love to have them as well.
So can I just ask, Peter, is five enough? Like if you put it the center five there on Bow Street, or spread them out along Bow Street, would that be enough to cover the shops and the restaurants on Bow Street? What do we really need on Bow Street?
Between John and I, you know, I'm sure he would love to have a couple spots. I mean, five is just a number I pulled out of my off top of my head, if you want to be polite. I mean, between John and I, we could probably use five spots or three spots, right? You know, we could split the difference between the two restaurants. But I think the city is going to have a big issue with having, A-frames out there once the snow starts flying.
Well, you know, if the snow starts flying and then you can move them, right? I think that certainly can help.
Well, there's also a 5 foot high snowbank along
there. Right. Yeah.
I come downtown with my Kubota tractor, and I open up spots for pedestrians to be able to cut through there.
Yeah.
But in doing so, half the time you just create an ice dam and you have a puddle there that's half feet deep that they wind up stepping in.
Yeah, I would agree with Peter. We could probably use six spots because I know there's Tugboat Alley and the store next to Peter. And, you know, I wouldn't mind in front of our restaurant. It could be, you know, it could be either, you know, we could have it, you know, space for like River House or Poco's or however it is so people can just go in. But Peter hit it right on the head. When the snow flies, I can't add anything new, but it's, all I can tell you is so Sir Walter Raleigh's cape wouldn't help getting people across sometimes.
What about, what about like making just more of the spaces downtown instead of designating them for particular businesses? What about just marking them more temporarily as 15-minute loading spaces? And if you want to go to dinner, park in the garage and pay $2. It's not expensive. Like, and then I just think like maybe we, because if I, you know, if you have 10, if you only serve dinner and you have 5 takeout spots and they're sitting there all day long and there's retailers next to you, like it's just going to cause conflict. It seems like more 15-minute spaces. If that, I don't know how the parking enforcement can handle that, but if they can't handle that, you know, maybe we get some ticket revenue and at the same time, some garage revenue. So it just seems like then the spaces are kind of more for everybody. If they're all 15-minute, they should still be relatively open. But I don't know how well enforcement works on the 15-minute spots we do have, so.
So Mimi, this is Nancy. I'm sorry that there's not someone from Public Works on this call. Usually Peter's on. Mm. Oh, Joe's there. Hi, Joe.
I'm here filling in for Eric Eby, and Peter's not in. So I am taking these notes to present to Peter and Eric. I don't want to pretend that I'm empowered in any way to influence the parking, but I will be sure to bring these up in detail to both Eric and Peter as soon as I'm able to, maybe even today.
So I just spoke to Mike Assad, who deals with the parking folks in the downtown, and the takeout spaces are still there. They mm-hmm. will be there until the council or policy is made to, you know, to break it down. So I think, again, this is another kind of thing that, you know, needs to reach the powers that be. I will bring it up at our core group meeting tomorrow with staff to see if there's a possibility to extend this all throughout the winter and how would we do that and could we increase it?
Great. I like the idea of 15-minute parking. And then, you know, anybody who wants to access either the retail or the restaurants can do that.
So to the educational campaign that Brendan mm-hmm. brought up, you know, I think there's that part. But I also think we should possibly think of some kind of relatively heavy campaign in terms of during the winter, you know, supporting Portsmouth restaurants and shops, right? And I don't know if it would be appropriate to use, we've been allocated $100,000 of what we've used is maybe $60,000. James, does that sound about right to you?
Yeah, it'd be nice to get an assessment of that.
Right.
I don't think the street committees use that much.
No, it's 50, and I don't think the street has used more than 10, you know?
I heard a number at one point. I almost want to say it was 12 or something like that. But yeah, it was low. I think the pop-up used all of their money.
Right.
And
so
we were given 25 and we haven't gone anywhere near spending it. And then there was 25 that was just for the things we hadn't thought of yet, I think is what right. we called it. And I don't know where that money landed.
Well, it's in the safe deposit vault, and called City Hall.
In June, and we didn't know what was coming, so we didn't earmark all the money.
Right.
But somewhere.
Does it make sense, and I know there are only 4 or 5 of you on, to try to get a group of restaurants, maybe, you know, 8, 10, and discuss this further, how we can, and I know you guys said takeout is a small part of your business, but if we can make it a bigger part of your business, and we can make it on top of people's minds instead of saying, you know what, I'm going to go to Market Basket and pick up some more food. You know, I know I've lost weight because I haven't been going out to eat much. But, you know, if we made it a real campaign of, you know, support your local restaurants and maybe you had a list of them or whatever and just kept that up somehow. I wondered if we could make it a bigger part of your business. And I don't know, I'm just thinking out loud.
Yep. Thank you. I think it's worth getting a group together and more restaurant people to chat about it. I think it's a great idea, Mark.
So will you and John and Brendan take that on?
If Valerie helps me.
She's on mute and we're not sure if she's shaking her head because there's something else going on.
I can see the thought bubble.
You know, I will always help you, Matt. You know, I will always help you, Massimo.
I know you will, but you have a lot going on. But yeah, that would be great.
Well, we did send out an invitation to this meeting to every single restaurant in town, to multiple people at each of those restaurants. So let's hope that we get a better response with the next go round. So sure, yeah.
And I'd like to consider Peter LaBrie if he has time. I'd love to get his input too, if he's interested.
If I could cycle back to the parking issue, and it's a rather longer range and less less certain possibility, but given that there is the possibility that the GSA is going to lateral arabesque the building over to us at the beginning of the year. In whatever form or fashion to take over, that I presume would give us access to the above ground parking, if not the underground parking as well. So it's potentially, we could think about whether or not that's either a location for some outdoor activities or plain and simple, let that be a more convenient place for the downtown restaurants and retailers for whatever framework of timing that might be. But it opens up a possibility above and beyond having people having to go up the hill to the parking garage.
Mm-hmm.
So might ease the burden somewhere.
Someone wanted to say something? Nancy.
John Gollum actually had reached out to us about checking in with our friends at GSA to see if it would be possible to offset some of the parking that has been taken up for the outdoor dining with spaces on at least Thursdays. I think now Fridays through Sunday, those parking spaces are available. And the city manager has brought that to our contact at GSA. I don't know why we haven't heard back yet, but I'll circle back with her on that.
Well, I can tell you that the in gate is no longer there. So, I realize they have guards with guns, but.
Right. Nancy, if you could check, just a clarification. I was looking for Monday through Thursday for everybody, mm-hmm. like after 5 o'clock, because they're still coming in during the day. I see that. And mm-hmm. to Alan's point, there's a security guard every now and then that sits by a chair in the lot to see anybody that comes in that doesn't belong there. So.
Right. So I wouldn't do it. But if after the first of the year, I mean, there's plenty of winter left mm-hmm. after the first of the year. And if things do go as could potentially go with GSA and, you know, turning over responsibility for the building to the city in whatever fashion that might take, it could potentially open up that space.
So the city would be willing to clear that of snow to keep it open?
Well, we certainly can discuss it with them. Exactly. Peter's not on the phone, but we certainly can discuss it with them.
I'm sure Joe's taking that note down, writing that note.
So anything else, anybody, especially the restaurateurs, any thoughts, suggestions on?
So I have one small-ish concern. I know we got the letter about storage of propane for Deputy Chief Howe. Can we translate that into an exact number of canisters and talk about the realistic? I mean, not realistic. I don't want to be. I'm not saying. I mean, we're going to do whatever's safe. We have, especially in, we're in a residential mixed-use building. So, but once every restaurant in town is running three and four of these propane heaters, and everyone is driving around town with, or every restaurateur is driving around town with propane tanks in their car, like what? What's going to be actual, you know, how much, I know my, the guys I buy from say it's not a problem, that they'll have plenty of canisters, but I just, I don't know, even in grilling, like peak grilling season, it can become a problem. So I don't know if anyone else is running into trouble with this, with actual fuel source, or if this has been covered and I just missed it. But I just want to make sure that we're all being safe and that it's also realistic. I thought when I read that limits, like if you have six heaters in use, you're already above what you're allowed to have on site or something. So maybe I'm wrong, but.
Yeah, let me just cover that real quick. And we did, and we can do it again. We didn't get much participation, but we did a Zoom with through the chamber and invited restaurants to ask any questions, because there's a lot of things. I couldn't put everything on the list, or else it'd be a huge book. Nobody's going to read it. I think it would be a good idea to do that. But I will answer your question that you just asked right now. So you're allowed to have the storage outside. You're not allowed to have it inside, and the quantities that you're allowed to have inside, you can't even have one regular like gas grill size, which is what everybody's using. You can't have one of those. Those are just you can have two, or if you're building sprinkler, four of like the camp size, the little 1 pound cylinders. But nobody's really using those. Those would run out really fast. What I had suggested was that perhaps some of the restaurants could work together and find a storage place that they could share. You know, for one thing, it's going to be cheaper to refill than to exchange your tanks. That would allow you to have more, but they also have to be stored somewhere secure. It has to be outside. There are rules. They'd be happy to go over them with anybody and help to try and find a spot if somebody in an area is willing to store them on their property to try and find a spot. So, but the answer is that you can't really store any of the 20 pound LP gas cylinders. State law doesn't allow it inside a building.
Are there other rules for quantities outside? I guess I only read the inside quantity because that's all I was paying attention to. And I thought we couldn't have it inside at all. So yes, that's correct. But how many?
So you know, outside, if they're in use, there's no limit. Okay, but you can't, because they're actually safer when they're connected to the appliance than when they're not connected to the appliance. So if they're in use or connected to the appliance, you can have one in every appliance. But you can't store your spares in the seating area outside. And they have to be stored somewhere that is secure. There is a limit to outside storage, but it's a fair amount, as long as they're being stored correctly, which should be secured upright so that the relief valve would work properly if necessary, and a ventilated, like you would see when you go to the store to do an exchange. They have the metal cages that are ventilated, so if there's a leak, the gases will build up. I really think that working together, the restaurants can come up with some ability to store enough to serve everybody.
Thank you. That makes a lot of sense.
Good. Anyone else? We're looking for the magic pill. Nancy, you have the magic pill. Excellent.
If I had the magic pill, I wouldn't work here anymore. Anyway, I did get the number from finance of how much the task force has spent to date. From the finance director, and she's saying, referring to pop-up Portsmouth task force, they've spent about $18,000 and have committed another $20,500 and change for a total of $38,306.
So that's just the pop-up.
Well, I'm not sure what other expenses the street committee had.
Yeah, I don't know if Peter was charging us to move things around or...
I do not believe so. I think that okay. These are the only charges for the task force, according to finance.
Nancy, okay. Would you mind repeating those really quickly?
Sure. Well,
18th was spent.
Yeah, $17,777.22 have been expended. And I'm going to round up here. $20,530 have been committed.
Okay.
For a total of $38,300.
Thank you very much.
If I may jump in, my understanding in the beginning at some point, there were some additional funds available that we could potentially use for either marketing, whether it be the takeout or some other, is that my understanding or?
Yes. It's somewhat discretionary, Massimo. You know, obviously we need to be fair to everybody, but yes, we have been allocated $100,000 by the city council to use generally, I would say, at our discretion, you know, the task force discretion towards helping businesses in Portsmouth reopen and thrive
right.
as much as possible.
Valerie, did you hear that? Where are you? You still here? We have roughly an additional $60,000 or so to spend, all right?
Great, I'm on it.
Yeah, we know we've committed $50,000 to pop up. And I don't know what we've been charged other things. So I would say we have, my gut feeling is we have 40 to 50
Fair enough.
Left. And I don't know if there's anything, you know, as you all think about, obviously the parking spaces is not much, but as you all think about things like how you expedite the takeout, you know, do you wanna, is there something we can put out on the streets, you know, hot boxes or, you know, start thinking creatively about how you can make that or something else a very much more efficient for yourselves. You know, it may be that we say we're going to hire, you know, 10 people on Friday and Saturday nights to watch the parking spaces. I don't know, but that's what we need your group of, if you and John and maybe Peter or whoever get together and get a group of restaurateurs thinking about how best to move things along and get food out of your kitchen.
Thank you.
Would there be an opportunity in, thank you, Mark. Would there be an opportunity in looking at insulated pouches for which to put the food in and the customer can take home? Is there a sponsorship opportunity there if somebody were to purchase them in quantity for the city? Because you've got the ordering down. Everybody knows how to order takeout. Everybody knows how to drive their car into town, and we've got some parking spaces. But the big question is, how do I get my gorgeous, yummy, scrumptious food from Massimo home in a condition that is still edible in the middle of February? And the answer to that, I think the missing link, the last, you know, it's like the last mile in cable is the most expensive. The last, you know, quarter mile to get your food home is going to be, how do we keep that warm? So insulated pouches with...
I don't know how you guys do it, but my food's always hot when I get home. I don't know. Magic.
Good. Anybody else?
One thing that, you know, it's nothing that you guys could probably even affect, but you know, winter is coming. We can't stop that. Outside seating is going to go away. Take it from someone who's had 120 seats outside on the waterfront for 10 years. Doesn't matter how much heat you throw at it. Mm-hmm. It's going to get cold. You're not going to be able to see it with wind. What we need is to increase our density for inside seating.
Yep.
With the social distancing at 6 feet, it puts, you know, an old building like Poco's or the River House at 30% occupancy, if that. Right now, the state is not allowing physical barriers to reduce that 6 foot social distancing. What we need is something to be put in front of the state to allow us to use physical barriers to decrease the distance between tables so we can increase the amount of people we can put into our dining rooms.
Absolutely, Peter.
You know, the only thing I've heard is that it's just period. Not physical barriers are not allowed. Why, I don't know. I know I can't mention any names, obviously, but I know a lot of restaurants that are moving forward and putting physical barriers in, and they are starting to reduce that distance. It's against CDC and, or not CDC, against state guidelines at this time, but they're hedging their bet that it's going to hopefully be coming down the pike.
Peter, I've seen it all day. Newburyport has it at the Black Cow. They have plexiglass that goes all the way up to the ceiling between their booths. I've seen it in Boston. I've seen it in a lot of places that they are doing a lot of that. And I don't know anything about it. You know, I want to make sure everybody's safe, that myself, my family, and my guests, number one. But there are other communities and cities and states that are able to do it. And I'm not sure why they are and we can't.
Mark? Yeah. Oh, wait. Peter?
No, I'm just saying. I mean, the magic pill is allowing the restaurants to increase their density safely so that we can have enough people in our restaurants to cover our rent, cover our labor, cover our food cost. You know, the River House especially is just not set up to do takeout. Our kitchen's in the basement. You know, there's no place to store and stack to-go orders. It's just, it's a physical, you know, barrier for us doing takeout. We need an increased density for our seating.
And everybody on this call, although the state says it's 100%, the restaurants in town, our smaller restaurants, are barely at 50%. You can't, with the 6 foot distancing, and I want the distancing, don't get me wrong, I want to protect myself, again, my family, my staff, and my guests, but it's no way to survive. There isn't that much margins in the restaurant industry. We won't survive it at the current capacity. Those who've been around for a long time, those who maybe aren't paying leases or rents that maybe own their spaces might be able to go a little longer, but the average restaurant is not going to survive. It's impossible. The math doesn't add up, you guys, that way. It just doesn't. If it did, I'd be rich and I'd be out of the industry. Yeah. Nancy and I would be on a cruise somewhere.
Let's go.
James.
You don't want to go on a cruise right now.
Right. No, you're right.
James, we had this discussion in one of our meetings, and maybe you can address it with the floor-to-ceiling plexiglass and the question about whether or not that reduces the airflow so that it actually is not safer. And I know, and I can't speak to that, but I think you did. And I just want to share, and I totally agree with you that it's about the indoor density. But there's a few things to deal with that I think we have to address and figure out how to get by. One is whether or not that air filtration, you know, that floor-to-ceiling plexiglass actually works or if it actually stops airflow. Another is when the governor was giving his very excited, you know, 100% indoors, I was getting texts from restaurants saying they're now getting calls from people saying, what does this mean about the reservation that I have with you? Does that mean that you're going to put all those tables and chairs back in there? And if it does, I'm not coming. So it's a consumer confidence issue just as much as it is a physical space issue. Mm-hmm. And how do we get by all of those? And going back to, we need some education programs, we need some social media, we need some of that discussion. But sorry, James, this is a very long way of asking respond to the idea of you know, really sectioning off the restaurants, because we've had those discussions.
Right. And I suspect the fact that you haven't gotten an answer as to why, I suspect it has to do with circulation of air and reducing the risk of infection if you have a contagious person.
Yeah, the droplets just don't fall to the ground if they come out of your mouth or your nose. They get caught in the air flows and moved around.
Mark?
John's had his hand up.
John?
I agree with everything Peter and Massimo said. The big thing, and I think everybody will agree, is the HVAC unknown. That is the biggest thing. Like I said, the plexi and all that, I totally understand, but the HVAC, that's the biggest thing. What's going to work? What isn't going to work? There's not enough, a lot of data around. And quite frankly, I don't know if there's going to be enough data around. So as like you said, Mark, you know, we can take and wait. And, you know, the next few weeks we get into October, we're going to see what the weather's like for November. But Peter's right on. He and I have been down on the waterfront for a few years. People are not coming out when you hit the 40s and 30s. It's not going to happen. It's just not going to. And we need to get inside. But you asked what, and again, the other restaurants are on here can correct me if I'm wrong. What we need help with is the HVAC. We can't wait to mid-November, November 1, the 10th or whatever, to say, okay, this HVAC isn't safe or the UV is good. That's what we need help from. We're going to be dead in the water if all of a sudden we get a ruling that no HVAC is good. Then we're dead. We're dead. Doesn't matter. And Peter's right. There are some restaurants that can do to go, but I'll be shutting down. It's just not going to happen. You're going to have one or two staff, and what are you going to do? I mean, it's not worth it. So we'll have to shut down. So that's the only, like Peter said, we need to get more capacity safely, but the HVAC, we need to get some answers on that from the health department, whoever it is, to figure out. We can't wait to November. We need to work on that. I don't know what everybody else thinks in a restaurant that's on the call.
I have to jump on a 3 o'clock call, John, but your point that about data, there's not a lot of data available. So it's the tact has been to try things, and the health committee is getting pretty close to issuing suggestions for what likely will work most effectively. And we're getting close to sharing that with everyone. There's no silver bullet, but there are a lot of publications and recommendations by ASHRAE and a couple other organizations, and we've been trying to put those in plain English and get those out to folks.
James, before you get on your call, do you have a timeline for that? I know that you've been put in charge of that task, and do you have a timeline of when you're thinking you might be able to release some of that information? It's getting cold, and we'd love to, we'd love to get going.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to make some edits after my 3 o'clock call and get that back out to the health committee that meets tomorrow, and then our group meets on Wednesday. So with a little luck, there'll be some information. It's basically relatively low cost, some no cost suggestions and priorities in order to help reduce risk.
So you have the information. You're just trying to compile it, and we're looking at where maybe like by the end of the week that information will be in our hands, James.
Wednesday, hopefully.
Great. And how will we get it?
It gets posted, but we would, Valerie would be able to send information out to everybody on her list.
Thank you. So that's the game plan. So by Wednesday and the week of the latest, we might have some of that information in hand.
Yeah. And don't expect anything too long about it.
Expectations are high. Come on, James.
It's mostly common sense.
Yeah. Thanks, James.
Okay. Take care, everyone.
Great. I think we all ought to, I have the same issue with 3 o'clock. So unless anybody has anything really important, I look forward to Valerie, you helping the restaurants get together and maybe coming up with thoughts and ideas, et cetera. I'll do a little more research on the inside density thing with the state. See if there's any thoughts of how to loosen that up or if they're working on it at all. And we'll get back on the takeout parking, etc. So we have these meetings, for those who haven't been here, we have these meetings every Monday at 2, okay? And Alan Gold is the keeper of the Zoom. Great. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
See you.